Hello and welcome everyone to today's webinar, Forces of Transformation, named Plastic Credits, Quo Vadis. I am Burcu Gözet, a researcher at the Wuppertal Institute, Division of Circular Economy, and I will be hosting today's webinar on the issue of plastic credits, in which it is our aim to generate an understanding of plastic credits, have a look at its benefits, as well as to oversee and discuss its risks. First, I want to give you some technical notes. The webinar will be recorded, but that does not apply to you. It's just a recording of the presenters, the presentation with an audio feed, and which will be made also available to you after the webinar for you to watch it again or share. If you look at your control panel, you will see that you can enter questions on the right side. Since you are muted, and unfortunately this cannot be changed in this program, please use this opportunity to ask questions and participate in this discussion with us later on. This being said, I'm very happy to welcome our panelists and experts on plastic credits today. We have Komal Sinha, Director of Plastics and Sustainable Development Policy and Markets at Verra. She is a climate and sustainability professional with more than 15 years of experience. She focuses on the global plastic challenge and inequality issues across the entire plastic value chain. And she is, among others, a member of Verra's Plastic Standard Development Committee. Welcome, Komal. And we also have Henning Wilts here, Director of the Division Circular Economy at the Wuppertal Institute. He is an expert on the topic of plastic waste prevention and circular transformation processes of the plastic industry. And last but not least, I'm happy to welcome Silvia Proff. She is also a researcher at the Wuppertal Institute Division Circular Economy, who was strongly involved in a pilot project on the implementation of plastic credits and a financed waste management system in a pilot project in India, and on which she will also provide us some insights today. Let me walk you quickly through the agenda through today's agenda. So we will have an introduction by Henning Wilts on the plastic credit system to look at its status quo, its potentials and risks. After that, Silvia Proff will have a deep dive and show us the insights of a pilot project from or implemented in rural regions in India. And this will be followed by Komal. She will give us insights on the plastic waste reduction standard. And after that, we have plenty of time for discussion, but also after each input, you will have some time to ask questions for each presenter or to each presenter as well. That is that's all from my side, and I'm happy to hand over to Henning Wilts for the first input.
Thank you very much for the kind introduction and for, of course, also for the opportunity to give a first input and introduction to this really exciting topic of plastic credits. And what I would like to do is to talk a little bit about why it is necessary, why we need innovative forms of financing circular plastic solutions, a bit about the potentials of plastic credits, and also the risks linked to that. And that will be based on a work that we did together with several companies offering plastic credits, as well as companies using plastic credits within the Prevent Alliance, a platform organized by GIZ, where we as Wuppertal Institute are happy to coordinate one of the task forces on circular plastics. And if we talk about plastics, I think it's important to take into account that we face a dilemma. We all have pictures like this in mind, horrible plastic pollutions in most of the countries around the globe, with severe impacts on the environment, but also impacts on human health. So it's absolutely clear, you know, we need better solutions. And at the same time, it's also clear that without plastics, you know, we will not be closer to a sustainable system of resource use. In many areas, you know, we depend on plastics in medicine, also in the automotive sector. It makes sense to have cars that are not as heavy as they are today. Also with regard to packaging, you know, we want to prevent food waste. You know, so in many areas, we need plastics. The question is, you know, what could be a system where also plastics fit into a sustainable, climate neutral circular economy? And that is especially an urgent question and a challenge, you know, if we look at the current system of how we used plastics in the past. You know, there was a really exciting study by Gaia and colleagues in California, who looked at the amounts of plastics that have been produced from the very beginning. So the fate of all plastic ever produced and ever recycled. And what they showed is that only 9% of the plastic that ended as waste so far has been recycled. And at the same time, they highlighted that 2.5 billion tons are still in use. And I think that is also important to take into account. There will be a big wave of plastic waste coming at us, so the challenge will become even bigger in the coming years. If we look at the current system, how we use plastic at the moment and how much we produce, and then you see here a figure put together by the colleagues at Conversio, and they showed we have an annual production of plastic of around 360 million tons. A lot of that becomes immediately waste. Plastic products are often used only for weeks, you know, or in the case of plastic bags, even just for hours. And looking at the current treatment options, you know, we see that of the plastic waste, 175 million tons are collected. Most of that still ends up in landfills. You know, we have an increasing share of energy recovery, so the plastic waste is burned. Still 75 million tons end up as unknown plastic waste. A lot of that waste ends up in marine ecosystems with severe impacts. So we're still quite far away from something that we could call a closed system. And then if we look into the future, it also becomes clear that the urgency of action, the amount of plastic production will increase by a factor 2. The amounts of plastic leakage into the ocean will probably increase by a factor 3. And that would lead to an increase of the plastic waste as stock in the ocean, here an increase by a factor 4. And all that shows we need not just incremental improvements, we really need a transformation to a circular plastic system. If we look at what the industry is doing at the moment, we all see that the big companies, they have published their pledge to reduce plastic waste or to use more recycled materials. If we look at what they promised and we look at the same time at the current development, you see here the comparison between a business as usual scenario and the current commitments, how far that is away from sufficiency, how far that is away from being an effective solution. So again, the key challenge is, what can the industry do to actually contribute to a circular system of plastics? And it's absolutely clear that such a circular system of plastics will have to include a lot of different circular economy approaches. We need, of course, waste prevention. We have to think about where does it actually make sense to use plastic. We need better recycling, we need better collection, we need an increase of recycled materials in the production. Now, all that has to be combined in a meaningful way and in a much more coordinated way than we do it at the moment. And that brings us to this topic of plastic credits. The question is, how could plastic credits offset part of the plastic pollution? The idea of plastic credits is, I think, currently raised a lot of attention. It offers opportunities for, especially for financing circular plastic systems. Companies compensate the amounts of plastic that they put on the market by paying waste pickers and recyclers who then collect plastic waste from the environment. So something borrowed more or less from the climate discourse, where we have the carbon credits, and then brought to this discussion on how do we get closer to a circular plastic system. And this was the starting point for one of the task forces within the Prevent Alliance, looking at the interlinkages between plastic credits and extended producer responsibility. Asking and discussing with a lot of different stakeholders, what are the requirements that might or that are necessary to ensure that plastic credits don't undermine incentives for setting up EPR systems, that they're also well aligned with incentives for waste prevention. How do we ensure that this actually makes sense? And what we see, and what I think also a lot of really interesting best practice examples highlight, are the potentials of systems. They work quite fast, and they have a lot of interesting socioeconomic benefits. They can secure stable income for waste workers, and we will see much more on that in our case study in India a bit later. From an economic point of view, the interesting thing is it's an efficient approach because it focuses on the low-hanging fruits. So the question that came out of that discussion in the task force was, what does the plastic credit system need in order to achieve global relevance? At the moment, this is a developing approach, but still very much in its infancy. So under which framework conditions could plastic credits become a meaningful solution for the challenges that we just discussed? And there are a couple of risks that have to be addressed for that, because plastic credits can be misused for greenwashing without any relevant positive impact, especially due to lacking transparency and definitions. What is actually a plastic credit? Who can define it? And I think this is also something what we will hear much more about from Komal. And part of that discussion, of course, what is the documentation of the collected amounts? How can we ensure that this is properly recycled and not just thrown away again after it has been collected? And also from the point of view, how do companies use these plastic credits? It's clear that they are not obligated to pay them. It's a voluntary measure, and they can only always decide to pay less in the following years. And so how can we make sure that plastic credits can also contribute to the long-term development of infrastructures for collection and recycling? This is, of course, something that also the plastic credit providers are aware of. They developed different requirements, focusing very much on the idea of additional efforts, showing that this goes beyond the business as usual approaches. And this is absolutely necessary. The interesting discussion that we had in the group was, how can we go beyond that? How can we make sure that plastic credits actually work well with extended producer responsibility? Extended producer responsibility, or EPR, is an approach that wants to make sure that companies take responsibility for the end of life costs of the product and material that they put on the market. And so this is an economic approach, a very efficient approach that aims to integrate environmental costs into the design and business model decisions of the companies. And it's absolutely clear it should be avoided that plastic credits undermine EPR approaches, for example, by focusing dust on the very valuable plastic amounts that then are collected, and the rest, the non-recyclable plastic, still ends up in the environment. This is something that clearly has to be addressed. Another point, plastic credits and waste prevention. The question is, how can we design plastic credit systems that they don't undermine incentives for waste avoidance? A company that claims to be plastic neutral, of course, raises the question, why should we invest more into less plastic waste if we're plastic neutral anyway? So the question is, now, what kind of system contributes to a situation where plastic credits don't give an alibi to postpone this transformational change for plastic? What we discussed are a couple of very concrete requirements. Plastic credits should only be sold to organizations that consistently prove that they explored all available options for waste prevention. So plastic credits should never be the cheap way out. The company should, in the very beginning, discuss how can we produce less plastic waste, and for that is unpreventable or unavoidable plastic waste, then plastic credits can make sense. Plastic credit systems should commit to invest a transparent share of their incomes into larger lasting infrastructures. So not a once-off cleanup activity, but plastic credits as something that contributes to this kind of investment that makes sure that also in the future plastic waste is properly collected and recycled. And final point, all investment and methodologies should be designed in a way that enables integration into EPR systems. And plastic credits shouldn't be an alternative or a divergence from EPR systems, but they should be set up in a way that they can contribute to a system where every company is obligated to pay for the end-of-life costs of their products. What we've seen is that these requirements and how they are implemented will depend very much on the status of EPR systems in different countries. We have a couple of countries with already fully established EPR systems, especially in Europe. We have a lot of countries that currently discuss how to set up EPR systems, and we have the majority of countries around the globe where this is still in the very beginning. And here exactly, I think plastic credits can play an important role. They can demonstrate that governments and companies are willing to take responsibility for this issue. In countries where EPR systems are currently being set up, plastic credit systems could, for example, contribute to developing a monitoring system. How much plastic waste ends up in the environment? How much of that is recycled? How much of that can actually be recycled? And so much, how much is recyclable? Where does it end up? And I think this can be a very important contribution of plastic credits to such a development. And then final point, countries with an already fully established EPR system, the question is what could be the role here? And for example, it could be interesting to discuss, can that contribute to solutions for multi-layer plastic that is very hard to recycle? Could it be implemented in specific regions or specific or including specific informal stakeholders? So also here, there are still challenges that could be addressed by plastic credit systems. And I think the most interesting discussion, and I'm also looking forward to the discussion today, how could we possibly integrate plastic credits into the current development of a global plastic treaty? The plastic treaty wants to look at the full life cycle of plastic from the design to the waste management. And the question is, what could be efficient ways to include a discussion on the opportunities and of course also risks of plastic credits? This just started. We had the first conference on the development just a couple of weeks ago. And I think also against that background, this discussion will become really important in the coming years. So really looking forward also to your feedback on that topic. With that, thank you very much. Looking forward to the rest of the webinar, and back to you, Burcu.
Thank you very much, Henning. So far, I don't see any questions on the chat. Maybe you're still typing. If there are any comments, please drop it in the chat, but we can also come to the questions later and just continue with the next input from Silvia Proff, who will give us insights on the pilot project.
Yes, thank you very much. I'm very happy to present to you the project that took place this year about plastic credits and that the Wuppertal Institute was a part of, and it carries the title Plastic Credits, Financing the Transition to the Global Circular Economy. So I'm going to give you a little bit of background information. The project was part of the Circular Solution Pilots organized by the Prevent Waste Alliance. And one goal was to set up a waste management infrastructure in some rural regions in India. And thereby, the project focuses on three pilot regions in the states Maharashtra, Kerala, and Goa. And the exact locations of the project locations you can see on the map on the right-hand side. And we worked together with our partner Repurpose in India on this project. And then we had one local partner operating in each of the three states. So what all these three regions had in common is that they don't have a functioning waste management infrastructure in place. That leads then to that especially low-value plastics, which are the ones that this plastic is focused on, are the ones that are not being picked up. Because often in India and the rural regions, informal waste pickers are working and they collect the high-value plastic that they can sell afterwards. So especially these low-value plastics with no market value are left out. And so the households, as they generate the waste, they have to burn it in front of their houses, or the plastic litter gets openly dumped and thereby leaks into the environment. And especially in two regions here in Goa and Kerala, because they are very close to the coast, these plastic then ultimately lead also into the ocean. So the role of the Wuppertal Institute in this project was to analyze the environmental benefits of the waste management system that was set up. And we did that by conducting an environmental impact assessment. And today I'm going to present to you the results of that assessment. But first, I'm going to give you a little bit more detail about what actually happened in this project. So it lasted 6 months. It started in April and it ended in September this year. And in all three regions, the low-value plastic waste was collected from households. It was then transported to a material recovery facility where it was sorted and baled, and then sent for further processing either to a cement kiln where it was incinerated, or to a recycling facility where it was mechanically recycled. And there on the top right, you can see a sketch of the value chain as it was set up in the region of Goa. And in the figure underneath, you can see the amounts of plastics that have been processed in each of the three pilot regions. So in total, more than 2 kilotons of plastic were collected throughout the project. A little bit more than 3/4 of those were incinerated in a cement kiln, and the rest was mechanically recycled. And as you can see also on the graph, the recycling took place only in Kerala. As 1 kilogram of processed plastic here refers to 1 plastic credit, in total, more than 2 million plastic credits were generated by this project. And now I'm going to come to the environmental impact assessment that we conducted, and therefore we have first a look at this environmental impact assessment matrix that we set up for once in order to structure our environmental impact assessment, but also to visualize the linkages between the project activities and the different environmental components. And you can see the different project activities here on the columns. So this is the collection, the sorting, and the treatment of plastic waste. And then the environmental components that we identified here are listed as rows. And wherever we see a connection between the project activity and the environmental component, the metrics would get a check mark. So we first identified three direct impacts. This is the changes of CO2 emissions and the usage of raw materials by the treatment of plastic waste. And the third one is the creation of jobs during the collection and the segregation steps. And then further, we identified five indirect impacts. And for each of them, we analyze here the negative impacts on plastic litter on the environment. And this then we link to the collection of plastic waste, because by the collection of waste, the environmental pollution of plastic litter is reduced. So I'm now going to go through each of the components and give you more details on them. And thereby, I'm going to start first with the direct impacts before I'm going to talk about the indirect ones. So we start with the CO2 emissions and the usage of raw materials. And for both of these impacts, we were able to quantify them. And therefore, I should mention that for the calculations of the CO2 emissions, we focused here on the incineration of plastic waste in cement kilns. And for this process, we found out that the collection and the sorting activities, as well as the transportation of the waste to the cement kiln and the emissions that are generated by this are actually negligible. And for the emissions that are caused by the incineration itself, we first calculated the emissions that are caused by the plastic waste that has been incinerated in the cement plant, and we compared then this value to the emissions that would have been created by burning coal instead. And the difference of these two values is then the 2.2 kilotons of CO2 equivalent that have been saved actually by this activity. Then clearly, when talking about CO2 emissions, recycling is always the preferred option, because here the carbon is actually not released, but it is stored inside the plastic particle. But for once, this is difficult here, as we are focusing on these low-value plastics, which include multi-layer plastics, and most of them are actually not suitable for recycling. But this is here even further restricted due to local infrastructures in India. Then by both these processes, so by the incineration of the plastic waste and by the mechanical recycling, we were able to substitute raw materials in the amount of 2.2 kilotons of coal and 390 tons of primary plastic. And then the third direct impact is the social component, employment. And as you can see here, more than 500 workers were involved in the project processes. And in a site visit, in conversations with the workers, we found out that the working conditions under which they are working are actually an improvement if you compare it with working conditions created by municipal waste management companies and also by the informal work that still takes place. And this is due to the provision of personal and protective equipment, but also because the workers were educated on hazardous materials and because the employers make sure that the workers are covered with health insurance. However, currently there's no payment for the workers in the case of a sick leave, but one of the local partners aims to change this in the future. And then last but least, we learned also that the empowerment of women is an important component here, as most of the workers in this project are actually women. And also they said that a stable income of their own is very important for them. And now I'm going to change to the indirect components. And as I said before, here we analyze the impact of plastic litter on the environment, which is then reduced by the collection of the plastic waste. And I'm going to start with the impact on the health. So once microplastics are uptaken by the human body, either through ingestion or inhalation, they can cause different harms. For instance, they can cause inflammatory reactions, but they can also release toxic substances into the body. These substances either accumulate on the plastic particles beforehand while they're still in the environment, or they might already been added to the plastic in the production process. And there still needs to be further research done and how this actually impacts human health, but it can already be said that these substances affect fertility, they can affect an unborn child, and they are likely to cause cancer. So the plastic litter also impacts wildlife, marine as well terrestrial wildlife, as they can get entangled in bigger plastic debris, which restricts their ability to move and to hunt, but this can even lead to death by strangulation, by suffocation, or by drowning. But as humans, also animals can ingest smaller particles, which then leads to health impairments. And just to name a few, the plastic particles inside the body of the animal can cause internal injuries, but they can also block their digestive system and by that suppress their feeling of hunger. And then last but not least, we analyzed the economic impacts of plastic litter on the fishing and on the tourism industry. And we found out that marine plastic litter causes very high economic costs on the fishing sector because plastic can damage the fishing vessel or also the fishing gear. By both, it reduces the fishing time of the fishermen, but it can further reduce their fishing time and their catch if the plastic gets caught up in the net and the fishermen have to spend their time unraveling it from it again. There is no study that quantifies this impact for India, but other studies for other countries have shown that the economic costs caused by plastic litter on the fishing industry can be easily millions of euros every year. And then next to the tourism, we analyze the impact on the tourism industry, which is a very important sector for India's economy, which we can see especially in Goa, which is one of our pilot regions, where the tourism sector contributes 30% to the gross domestic product. And also here, plastic litter has a negative effect on the revenue because it decreases the recreational value of the environment. And then tourists decide not to travel to that destination or to shorten their visit. And by that, the tourism sector loses its revenue. And then to conclude, I think we saw that the project has various positive effects on the environment, which includes the reduction of CO2 emissions, which includes the substitution of raw materials. It has further a positive social impact by the creation of jobs that have better working conditions than those that are often offered by the municipality on site. Then further, by the collection of more than 2 kilotons of plastic litter, the amounts of waste that gets leaked into the environment has actually been reduced. And that in turn then has a positive effect on human health, on terrestrial and marine wildlife, as well as on the economic revenue of the fishing and the tourism sector. However, further research needs to be done here in order to quantify these indirect impacts that we have analyzed here. And then lastly, the project has shown us that plastic credits can set an incentive here for the collection of low-value plastics, which are in these regions often the plastics that are not picked up because of their low value and therefore are the ones that are most likely to be leaked into the environment. And with this, I'm finished and I thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much, Silvia. It was nice to see the direct as well as the indirect potential benefits that plastic credits can have when there is waste management systems financed, especially in this case in rural areas where no such systems were in place before. So with this, I think we had a really nice and positive pilot project to present, as well as we heard the risks that come along with plastic credits. And now I'm really excited and looking forward to hear the processes from or towards plastic credits standardization. So Komal, please, your input, if you like.
Sure. Thank you, Henning and Silvia, for the very insightful presentation. So I will just try to build on that by providing you more detail on Verra's plastic standard. Henning very, I think, clearly sort of highlighted how plastic credits have gained a lot of attention in the last few years as a promising market instrument to drive investments into underfunded waste management organizations and increase recycling rates. However, we also do know that there's lack of clarity in terms of, you know, what the plastic credits' role is, what they can or cannot do, and where do they fit into the waste management hierarchy. And also recognizing the fact that the extent of the plastic challenge and the amount of funding that is needed to bridge this gap, Verra last year launched the plastic standard, which is a global framework for consistent accounting and crediting of a range of plastic waste collection and recycling projects. So also recognizing the lack of awareness and the uncertainty that kind of surrounds this novel promising market instrument, I would like to present to you the plastic standard and how it can be used to certify and issue plastic credits. Before that, a quick introduction to our organization, Verra. So, founded in 2007, Verra is a not-for-profit organization that manages and owns a range of standards that help the private sector, civil society bodies, and governments meet their ambitious climate and development goals through some of these standards that you see on the screen. Out of these, our most widely used standard is the verified carbon standard that was released in 2006. And to date, it has more than 1,800 projects registered across 25 different project types and 70 countries. One of Verra's key strengths is the ability to convene a diverse range of stakeholders to develop workable frameworks and drive finance to high-performing projects, policies, and actions. But today, the focus is going to be on the plastic standard and how it is used to generate and issue plastic credits. And before even starting to talk about the plastic standard, just a quick primer on why plastics. I think everybody who's here on this webinar has a fair idea about that, but just I think very quickly from Verra's perspective, there are two angles to the plastic problem. One is the environmental angle and second is the human angle. Henning already touched upon it, so I'll keep it short. So more than 350 million tons of plastic leak out into the environment every year. Even less than 9% of it is now being recycled, if the EMF latest report is anything to go by. And much of it leaks into the marine ecosystems and wreaking havoc on the marine life. I think the human angle is actually even worse. So 3 to 5 million informal workers are engaged in plastic waste collection and recycling activities, particularly in developing countries, where they work under extremely unsafe and hazardous conditions. They are at the bottom of the social ladder and are overworked, you know, undervalued, underpaid, several gender inequality, harassment issues that they have to face on a day-to-day basis. So I think the situation is a bit grim that side, but we've also seen a sliver of hope where in the last few years, several consumer goods companies have shown interest in supporting plastic waste collection and recycling projects, particularly in their key production regions. But I think one of the limitations of this is also that current economics of plastic waste management do not incentivize recycling. And therefore, we need innovative finance mechanisms that can deliver transformative and sustainable business models to keep plastic in circular systems. And that's where I think the role of the plastic crediting mechanisms come in. And with that intention, Verra developed two sort of frameworks. So working with the 3R initiative, we developed the plastic stewardship guideline for the plastic stewardship accounting, which provides a framework for companies to measure the plastic footprint, mitigation methods, and how plastic credits can then be used to make credible and robust claims. And that sort of is a guideline to safeguard companies against the accusations of greenwashing. And second is the plastic standard, which provides criteria for generation of plastic credits. Now, so the overarching program itself is the plastic program, which has four components, at the heart of which is the plastic standard. So plastic standard provides the rules and requirements that the company must adhere to for it to be certified under the plastic program. And there are three other modules, as you can see there. So accounting methodology, essentially any company seeking registration, any project seeking registration under the plastic program should be able to quantify the impacts of the plastic waste collected or recycled using technically robust methodologies. And plastic program currently has two methodologies. one for plastic waste collection and the second is for plastic waste recycling. More methodologies will eventually get developed as we identify more needs, either downstream or upstream. But yeah, it really depends upon where that need is identified. Independent auditing. So every project seeking registration needs to go through an independent third-party validation and verification process through expert organizations approved and accredited with Verra. And this step is really critical to ensuring integrity of the program and making sure that there are no internal biases. And registry system, so there is a need for a transparent registry, and there is a Verra registry, which is the central storehouse of all the information related to registered projects, where anybody can basically track information related to the plastic credits that have been registered, issued, retired, and cancelled. And it is really available to the public, so it's publicly available. Now, I think just taking a step back as to why do we even need the plastic standard and what are the benefits? So the objective of the plastic standard is to support and scale up activities that increase plastic waste recycling and collection from the environment in line with environmental and social safeguards. The plastic standard catalyzes investments in high impact projects that have the ability to increase the availability of recycled feedstock. And this criteria, we are seeing that it's becoming more and more important going forward as several regional policies and, you know, voluntary mechanisms have built in recycled content targets, which is a great step in the right direction. But it also means that there is a lot of data basically points towards a projection that the demand for recycled content will far outstrip the supply because of these policy and mechanism integrations. And this is where plastic credits again have a role to play, because I mean, I also read a Bain & Co. report that came out some time back, which said that by 2030, only about 10 to 14% of the total plastic consumed will be recycled, which kind of leaves a huge gap between the demand and supply. And what this could mean essentially is that it would inflate the prices for recycled content in the short term, which would mean that the users would start to shift towards more cheaper alternatives that would suppress the demand for recycled content permanently. And this is not a good sign. And that's where I think plastic credits could have a role to play, because the plastic credits can provide investments in order to scale up recycling infrastructure, which can contribute towards bridging this gap between projected demand and supply. Plastic standard can also address social risk across the value chain. And as Henning also kind of alluded, that the Global Plastic Treaty just concluded. And one of the bigger talked about issue is how to make it inclusive by incorporating the interest of the informal sector and identifying and mitigating the human rights issues that are inherent in the sector. And that's where I think plastic standard has a very huge role to play, because the standard already has recognized some of these health and social risk issues and has built in proactively several safeguards towards safe working conditions, fair wages, livelihood improvement opportunities. And there is also an active stakeholder consultation process that is built in that makes sure that the directly impacted stakeholders are consulted throughout the project process. So the plastic standard builds in requirement for generation of plastic credits, which will be generated when there is an additional collection or recycling of plastic waste over an established baseline. And there are multiple use cases of plastic credits. So one is companies can really use it to make voluntary commitments in a robust and clear way. And some of the commitments that the 3R guideline supports are net zero plastic leakage into nature, net 100% recycled at end of life, net circular plastic. The guidelines do not advocate or support the plastic neutral claim, and there are many reasons because of the several underlying issues associated with it, which we can touch upon towards the later part of the presentation. And the other use cases essentially are supporting extended producer responsibility schemes. Henning again spoke about it at length, so I'm not going to go into the details of it, but I think it's important to mention that there is definitely merit in extended EPR schemes and plastic credits to work together, because they have a very shared common goal, and there is merit in them working together as opposed to working in silos or working as parallel schemes. Scope of the plastic program. So what really are the material types that are eligible? So as you can see on the screen, all material types that are made out of the seven plastic types plus composite materials that contain plastic. are eligible to generate plastic credits through the mechanism. The type of activities that are eligible are also multiple, including informal waste collection activity, community waste collection, municipal or private infrastructure, infrastructure development, as well as mechanical and chemical recycling. We also touched upon a little bit on the importance of high integrity principles that should underpin the program to make sure that the credits, that the risks associated with credits is mitigated. And keeping this in mind, we have 7 quality assurance principles that underpin Verra's plastic program. And I will talk about them really quickly. So as you can see, the 7 principles, the first one is real, which means that the project should be able to demonstrate that there is actual plastic waste collection or recycling activity happening on the ground. Independently audited, which I touched upon before, is basically to make sure that the projects are independently validated and verified with expert agencies to ensure that there are no biases and to make sure that there is a third party audit process in place. Measurable, again, like I touched upon before, it means that any project seeking registration should be able to quantify the collection and recycling impacts in line with approved, globally approved, technically robust methodologies. And the 2 methodologies that we have in place are for collection and recycling at the moment. Uniquely numbered, this is also very interesting. So any plastic credit that is issued on the Verra's registry is uniquely numbered, and this sort of protects against the risks of double counting. And in the next slide, I will talk a little bit about how they are codified. Additional, this is sort of one of the core principles of plastic credit, and additionality essentially means 2 things. One is for the project to be able to demonstrate incremental collection over an established baseline. And second is for the project to be able to demonstrate through a series of tests that this project would not have occurred without the revenue in the form of plastic credits. Transparently listed, again, there is a Verra registry on which you can track each and every project that has been listed, registered, all the plastic credits that have been issued, retired, and so on, and conservatively estimate. So any type of estimations that you apply should not under or over inflate the amount of plastic credits that are issued. So in the spirit of transparency, I think Verra Registry sort of is the central storehouse where you can track any project-related information, and that is a screenshot of what sort of information you can find on the registry page. So project unique ID number, the project details, project brief, all of the documents that have been uploaded related to the project registration, verification, monitoring, and so on. Who's the project proponent? What is the type of project, whether it is a collection or recycling project or both? What is the status, the amount of plastic credits that have been issued? So once the project is verified, then the plastic credits are issued, and that's when you can see the plastic credit serial number. And there is an example at the bottom, which is quite long, but it really, in the next slide, you'll be able to see what that codification really means. So the serial number essentially is a combination of, you know, the type of plastic, who's the auditor, what is the monitoring period, what is the end of life, which country is the project located in, and so on. So all of this information can be tracked through the serial number, and that's what makes each plastic credit unique from the other one. And additionality, again, without going into too much of technical details, like I mentioned, this also is a very important component of the plastic program and the way plastic credits are generated. And there are a series of tests, which is called sort of a decision tree approach to determining whether your project is additional and therefore eligible under the plastic program. So you first need to demonstrate that the project is not mandated by any regulation. And if it is mandated by any regulation, then it is not eligible to generate plastic credits. Positive list, so several projects that are located in, let's say, least developed countries or small island developed states fall into the positive list and therefore are deemed additional, which means that they are eligible to generate plastic credits, all other criteria being met. And this essentially means that it is indicated with high confidence that this project is in need of financial support. Penetration rate again determines that the project is not a common practice in the region, an investment analysis is for the project to demonstrate that the project is economically or financially not attractive on its own and therefore needs the investments in the form of plastic credits. In line with also in addition to the quality assurance principles I described, it's also very important to ensure that the plastic credits that are being generated or the plastic standard that is developed has a robust governance and development process in place. And there is a very rigorous multi-stakeholder consultation process that we put in place in order to develop and maintain the plastic standard. So the plastic standard was initially developed by putting together a plastic standard development committee in place that brought in stakeholders from across the value chain who provided their inputs and various components of the standard, including, you know, baseline, additionality, the type of activities and so on. And using their inputs, the first version of the plastic standard was developed. The two methodologies were developed by two expert organizations in their field. There was a smaller assessment working group which supported the development of auditing third-party accreditation criteria. Several experts, also known as technical advisors, were consulted on several key components of the standard and the methodologies. And to support the technical and strategic evolution of the plastic program, we also put together a plastic program advisory group that continues to advise on how the plastic standard should evolve, taking into account the concerns and the issues and the industry trends across the plastic value chain. And this is a quick diagram just to illustrate the material and credit flow. And it's very simplistic, I do admit, but I think multiple iterations of this is possible. But conceptually, this is how it'll work. So let's take a scenario where an informal worker collects plastic waste from the environment and it is segregated broadly into recyclable and non-recyclable plastic waste. The non-recyclable plastic waste, let's say it is deposited in a government certified landfill that meets all the criteria as laid out in the standard, or let's say it is sent to a cement kiln for co-processing. That volume of plastic that is kept out of the environment has the ability to generate waste collection credits. And the recyclable plastic waste is then sorted by type and sent to recycling facilities where it is recycled and kept in the circular loop. And this material is capable of generating waste recycling credits. And one project can generate both waste collection and recycling credits based on the end outcome and once the additionality criteria on both ends are met. So the registration or certification of a project under the plastic program is a fairly robust process. And as you can see, there is a range of documents that need to be completed and provided. And while some might say that this is slightly onerous, I think this is very important, like I said, to ensure that right amount of rigor is put in place to ensure high quality credits are generated from the process. I'm not going to go into too many details of it, but I think the standard documents are the ones that you need to refer to in order to complete the templates and forms. And the most important ones are the plastic standard, the methodologies, the program guide, and the definitions. And templates and forms include the project description, validation, verification, monitoring report, and a few representation towards the legal ownership and title of the project or the facilities. And once I think what we also continue to hear is that we understand all how it works in theory, but what next? How do we get started? So Verra published a quick guide on the website as well, which provides a very clear step-by-step process as what the project developer can undertake if they want to register their project under the plastic standard. So first you need to review all the documents, assess eligibility. You review the fee schedule that's also there on the website. You understand the project life cycle and the registration process before you get started. And at any point, if there is any issue related to the process or any questions, you should feel free to get in touch with our team, the plastic standard team. And yeah, I mean, coming towards the end of the presentation, just a quick snapshot of where we are in terms of the number of projects. So the first project got registered and issued credits earlier this year. That's the Second Life project in Thailand, which is both a collection and recycling project. There are more than, I think the slide is slightly dated because we've seen a huge uptick of projects that are now seeking registration under the plastic standard. So I think more than 10 projects that are currently under final stages of validation and verification, more than 20 projects that have been listed, and listing is the first step towards the registration process, and 734,000 kgs of plastics has been collected and recycled using the plastic standard, or 734 plastic credits have been issued till date. And before I end this presentation, I just want to leave you with a few images from the projects that have been registered or are seeking registration. We project that more than 1 million tons of certified plastic waste will be collected and recycled by 2030. And it's really region agnostic, so it's very encouraging to see projects coming from all across the globe, including, you know, Australia, Canada, African regions, India, Southeast Asia, and so on. So that sort of brings me to the end of the presentation. A few visuals from the Dikali project in Senegal, from the Second Life project in Thailand, and so on. So that sort of is how I'd like to conclude my presentation, but any questions, welcome. Thank you.
Thank you very much. This was highly interesting. I would directly have a question, and maybe I, with that, already the discussion starts. But also from the panelists, feel free to raise your hand if you have any questions, because mine is directly to your presentation. I was wondering, and I guess you haven't touched upon it, but what can companies actually claim when they have the certification by Verra?
Yeah, so that is a good question. And I think before I dive into that, I can provide a little bit of context. So like I mentioned, so Verra was a part of the 3R initiative that developed the guidelines for corporate plastic stewardship, which is the first integrated framework that provides guidelines for, you know, corporate footprint measurement, mitigation, and the sort of claims that companies can use in order to showcase their voluntary commitments. And how can they use waste collection and recycling credits in order to meet these commitments? There are, I think, three claims that are proposed, which include, I think that was there in the presentation as well. So net zero plastic leakage into nature, net 100% recycled at end of life, and net circular plastic. And like I also mentioned, we do not support plastic neutrality as a claim because of various underlying issues associated with it. But we also do admit that currently there is no single claim that can be backed by the entire industry. So if you look at the analogy would be in the carbon world, we have net zero claim, but something similar does not exist in plastic right now. And therefore, I think there is a situation where everybody is doing their own thing, everybody is using their own claims, which leads to a little bit of confusion in the market. And we identifying and understanding this gap, we are now a part of a larger initiative and effort whose, amongst other things, whose aim is to really to be able to identify and develop simple yet technically robust claims that can then be used by, you know, brands and plastic credit practitioners worldwide to communicate their achievements through a combination of reduction initiatives and plastic credits. So you'll hear about this more in the coming year, but just to say that this is an area that we do understand needs a bit of work.
Thank you, Komal, for your answer. Henning, you have a follow-up.
Komal, one of the topics that we also discussed in the working group were the huge differences in prices for plastic credits. Do you think there is already sufficient transparency in with regard to what one plastic credit actually covers? And do you think that it's, that the differences are actually justified by different activities, or is it qualities, or how is Verra thinking about to maybe also address this topic?
Yeah, that's a good point. And Verra cannot take a position on the price, so we cannot really directly start talking about the prices because it will lead to conflict of interest as we are the developer of the standards. But I think certain things are very logical in terms of how the prices should be set. So what we have seen really is there are, similar to the carbon market, there are also certain charismatic projects. So which could be projects located in, you know, in the coastal or the rural regions of let's say, lower income communities, regions. Those are the projects that are seen as more attractive, or projects that occur in the small island developed states where I think there is no system for collection or infrastructure, informal collection systems where social safeguards are built into it and they go above and beyond the lay of the land. So let's say building sanitation services, drinking water facilities for the informal sector. I think where those sort of social parameters are also integrated have the propensity to fetch a better price. But to be honest with you, I think it's very early days for us to be able to also understand what is driving prices. And we also don't have any public reports like we have seen in carbon, where there is comparison of, you know, these are the kind of projects that will fetch these kind of prices. So I think it's sort of an informed guess at the moment, but I think it's also informed by what we have seen happening in other sort of crediting mechanisms.
So we have a question from the audience. It says, one project activity purchases plastic from waste or scrap dealers and recycle it. So is the project activity eligible for plastic collection credits? I would maybe ask Silvia first, from her, based on her experience on the pilot project, how the crediting took place, and then maybe the perspective from Verra as well.
So in our project, actually some of the local partners work together also with informal waste pickers, so not all of the collection is really included in the project. And the credits though that are given out for our project are not given out based on the collection, so the amount that has been collected, but on the amount that had been processed. So that would be so you could work together with informal waste pickers and then treat the plastic further and then create a credit for this.
Yeah, I can also just add a little bit to it. So it really depends upon the baseline situation. So what would have happened in the absence of, or what was the business as usual scenario? So where would have this plastic ended up if it had not got the revenue in the form of plastic credits? If it's already being directed to recycling facilities, means that there is already incentive for it to get recycled, then probably it will not generate credits. But if, let's say, it was ending up in the environment, it is being collected through the revenue from plastic credits and ending up for recycling, then it has the potential to generate credits. So,
all right, thank you. And then I would also like to come back to the prevention issue, to the prevention of plastic waste. Henning touched upon it. And as you already said, Komal, you would distance yourself from the claim of plastic neutrality. So I would also like to ask Henning, would you say that this claim, like plastic neutrality, is the risk and interferes with the incentives, with setting incentives towards plastic waste prevention?
I think there's at least an unnecessary risk, because if a company can actually say we are plastic neutral, where should be the incentive for anyone in the company to invest into a more efficient use of plastic, so leading to less plastic waste? Why should they invest into reusable packaging solutions, for example? And so I think there is the risk that it actually undermines the activities of those within companies working on these issues. And then I think the more general question that I would have to the claim of being plastic neutral is the company still puts plastic products on the market. It doesn't really know what the impacts are. So I think there's a big risk of greenwashing linked to that. There are, of course, companies who say, we want to be absolutely sure we buy double the amounts of plastic credits compared to what we put on the market. And of course, that makes sense if it leads to an actual improvement of environmental qualities and better collection. But I'm asking myself if anyone involved in these activities actually benefits from claiming itself plastic neutral. I don't see the benefit from that.
Yeah, definitely. I can talk a little bit about Henning, I think, very, very clearly highlighted the importance of claims, and we also talked about it a little bit. And I think I'd also touch upon Verra's position on plastic credits in the entire life cycle, both upstream and downstream. And the way we think about it is we strongly believe that companies need to prioritize upstream interventions, including in your reduce, recycle, designing for recyclability, redesign interventions, and so on. But at the same time, we also see that despite the most aggressive interventions, there is still finance and investment needed to keep plastic out of the environment and into circular systems. And therefore, our understanding is that in tandem with measures taken within the supply chain, companies should use plastic credits to address plastic waste that occurs downstream of their operations. So just to reiterate, I think our view is that plastic credits should complement upstream interventions and should not be used as a license to continue business as usual operations.
Thank you for this clarification. There's also another question again addressed to you. Just one second, I'm opening it, I think. Yes, so the question is, can the plastic, which is feasible for recycling, be claimed for both collection and recycling? And then it continues, only which cannot be recycled can be claimed for collection.
Collection, yeah. So prima facie, yes, depending upon where the baseline is and where how the additionality is determined. So let's say if the plastic is lying in the environment and it is being collected and sent for recycling, it has the potential to generate both collection and recycling credits. And at the same time, if the baseline is that the project, if the plastic was lying in the environment, being dumped or openly burnt, non-recyclable plastic is being sent to government-certified landfill or for co-processing, it has the potential to generate waste collection credits. But I mean, to be honest with you, there are also other factors at play, so applicability conditions, eligibility, all of those have to be met. But prima facie, yes, I think this is the context.
Thank you. And I think, Silvia, again, from the pilot project, we have seen this is also something we can like agree upon, that recycled material is usually, or waste are implemented so that they are going to a recycling process or implemented into a recycling process. And I would maybe also address you, Silvia, towards the waste prevention aspect. Is there anything like from the actions on site within the pilot project, has there been the aspect of prevention as well?
Yeah, thanks for the question. So the prevention itself was not in the focus of the project, and yeah, as we're here not focused on prevention of the organizations that are actually purchasing the plastic credits, but from the other side speaking, there were some awareness raising programs that happened on site with the households involved. And but this is only a guess, of course, that can lead to more awareness of the people about plastic litter, about pollution and their impacts, and therefore lead to prevention. But this would be only speculations, as we don't know what the actual outcome of these awareness programs were.
Thank you. And looking at the time, maybe I would use the remaining 15 minutes to put this discussion to level it up into the political level. You mentioned EPR systems already. Henning, you listed some requirements, for instance. Komal or Henning, whoever wants to start first. So what are the processes at the moment? Do you have any good examples, for instance, where you can see how plastic credits is smoothly implemented into the EPR system? Henning, you want to start first? Do you have any examples?
Well, we've been looking for that within the working group, and then decided that there is no general answer to that question. Does it work well? It depends very much on the countries, also the approaches, how EPR is going to be implemented there. What we did was conducted interviews with people working with plastic credits and setting plastic credits up in the countries in, I think, 10 different countries. And what we've seen is the variety of approaches. So what we discuss here, plastic credit means something completely different in different parts of the world. And we see that also the scope is very different. In some countries, we have plastic credits that, for example, explicitly address reuse, so also waste prevention, the amounts of waste that are put on the market, the ambition of companies working on that. And in others, the focus is very much on end of pipe solutions, so improving collection, improving recycling. And I think this is, Komal mentioned it, the need to standardize different components also of plastic credit systems, that is absolutely crucial. And I think what we try to do also with the working group is to improve the exchange of experiences between different countries. Currently, there's often a tendency to reinvent the wheel every time we put up a new system. And there, it could create really interesting synergies to bring people working in Mexico with those working in Indonesia, for example, in contact. And yeah, I'm really looking forward to trying to establish that cooperation within the PREVENT in the coming year.
Yeah, I can add to that. I mean, in one of the things is that there's a lot to learn from other mechanisms as well. So in the carbon world, we've seen how carbon taxes and carbon credits have worked together in Colombia, South Africa. So there's a lot of things that we can learn. Like Henning mentioned, no need to reinvent the wheel. I think a lot of examples already exist. And we've also been seeing some of the regions starting to take notice of plastic credits and started to incorporate it in their notifications. We've seen that partly happen in India, also in Philippines, which very explicitly talks about plastic credits and how they can be used to fulfill EPR obligations. But I do think that these are still early days. And when you speak with the regulators, you'll see that they still need to figure out a lot of details in terms of, how it will actually work, what sort of infrastructure needs to be set up, how does it interact with existing standards like various plastic standard and so on. So I think the effort from our side is underway to actually see what sort of how plastic standard and credits can be integrated, because there is a lot of thought that needs to go into this in order to make sure that it operates smoothly. So yeah, I mean, we don't have all the answers at the moment, but I think what we want to do is take some of these regions, develop case studies to demonstrate how the two can work together, develop workable frameworks from there, and then take it to other regions where it can be replicated. So that sort of is the idea for us in the new year. And we'll hopefully have more exciting updates when we speak next time.
So there will be another webinar next year on this topic, again, status quo and quo vadis. Maybe also have a look on the global plastic treaty. Henning, again, you mentioned it already, and your input already sounded like a discussion. So maybe again, or directly towards you, how can plastic credits, or how should plastic credits be considered within the plastic treaty? How or which position can it even take?
Well, I think that will be an interesting discussion. I don't have a final answer to that, but what we see is that the plastic treaty aims to develop a very comprehensive approach on plastics. So, as I said, looking at incentives to improve the design of products, to also replace plastics where it makes sense, down to the waste management activities, and then actual leakages into the environment. And with that really high ambition, the need for financing will be enormous. We will need financial resources to implement all these infrastructures to incentivize this transformation. And a lot of that money will have to come from private companies. And I think here, in order to be able to act fast, I think here could plastic credits really be an important part. There is the discussion, we have now started the discussion on multilateral financing mechanisms. And I think that should be the place to talk about how could we integrate plastic credits as a tool for fast and efficient financing of setting up additional waste infrastructures. I think that should be, from my point of view, the issue that discussion should focus on.
Thank you, Henning. And yeah, just in terms of where Verra is on this as well. So we participated in the INC, the first meeting of INC, that just concluded earlier this month. And earlier to that, we also put out a position statement, and just yesterday also a commentary on how plastic credits can be integrated into the treaty. And for us, I think it has been developed at the back of one of the documents, the working group documents called Plastic Science, which recognize plastic credits as one of the downstream instruments. So what we did is that we took that and we built upon that, because we feel that there's so much more that plastic standard can do. It's not just plastic credits and not just a downstream instrument to clean up the waste that has ended up. But there are five things that I can quickly talk about, and then it's more detail is there on the website and also on social media. So one is plastic credits can complement upstream actions. Like I mentioned, it should complement upstream interventions as opposed to being used as a standalone tool. The second is plastic standard can support the harmonization of measurement and monitoring principles. I think the document has called out the need for harmonization of monitoring and measurement principles, and also leaning on existing frameworks as opposed to reinventing the wheel. And that's where I think plastic standard, the two methodologies can come in, because it has very detailed requirements for how you can measure the impact of collection and recycling activities, how to determine the amount of plastic waste collected, and so on. So I think that's the second role. Third is in jumpstarting EPR schemes, which we have talked about at length today. Fourth is driving finance to vulnerable and at-risk geographies. So there are so many geographies where EPR doesn't exist, and it is high rates of plastic waste management, either because of transboundary movement or because they don't have infrastructure of their own. I think these are the regions where plastic credit can have maximum impact. And the fifth is really the key to developing or delivering an inclusive treaty is through recognizing the health risks and the social risks of the informal sector and including them in the negotiation process. And that's one of the things that Plastic Standard has done at the outset as well, so through the social safeguards that we have built in the standard. So I think those are like high level positions, but feel free to please read through and leave any comments that you might have on how you feel we could better sort of take this approach to INC2.
Any direct comment on this, maybe, Henning? Or can we continue with the next question? I mean, you can discuss if you feel like it.
No, I think the INC2 will be an interesting event, with a lot of countries now aiming to focus on their national action plans and stating that they take care of what they have to do on their own, and they don't want any global ambition, and they don't want any global quantified targets, and they don't want any multilateral financing mechanism. And I think plastic credit could be something that brings the different positions together, where we see we need standardized mechanisms, and then we need regional or national implementations. I'm not 100% sure that we will end up with a really good treaty. So a lot of additional effort will have to go into making that sure.
Thank you for that. I will take one last question from the audience, and then we will have our closing remarks with looking at the time. And there was a question, I think I'm pretty sure it relates to the pilot project. It says, how did you deal with the lack of infrastructure in the area? What were your first actions? So Silvia, since I was on site, if you feel like it, I can report on what I saw on site. And also I had the chance to talk with the local partners. So what we saw there was that the waste management system were actually grassroots activities. So we had even only one person who was really willing to adapt a collection system in their city or in their village. So they started collecting and selecting the waste by themselves, and then started talking to the village representatives. And step by step, it took years to actually have the municipalities involved to get some support on that. And yeah, so we saw that, especially in those areas where no waste management systems are in place and where plastic credit can or is a key financing mechanism, that local partners are supported who have a really like big ideology behind it. And it already has been mentioned a few times that social safeguards are also a big part of this. And we have seen the social benefits next to the environmental benefits as well. I think that's a good point to mention and highlight here. And this being said, maybe I would leave you 1 or 2 minutes each, or 1 or 2 sentences, however you like, to maybe state your key perspective on plastic credits again. So what is the next key step for that? So maybe whoever wants to start first. Oh, maybe that's too complicated. Oh yeah, Henning. Okay.
I think the thing that I'm highly interested in is, how does buying plastic credits change the culture and the ambition of companies? Now, is it on the one hand that they think, okay, now we solved that and let's move on? Or does it raise awareness for the issue? Does it is it a starting point for additional measures to work on more sustainable solutions? And I think both ways seem plausible, and we don't have any data, any evidence on what is actually on what we actually see in reality. And I think this is what we would like to focus on in our further research.
Okay, thank you. I think I would be speaking out of the perspective of the pilot project again. And I think we saw there were lots of positive impacts, lots of things that went well. But I would be very careful in attributing all of them just like this to the plastic credit system. But in order to ensure that this can be attributed to a plastic credit in the future, I think standards would be helpful to ensure, for example, that social safeguards are implemented, and maybe even that a value to the plastic credit is added depending on the waste management strategy that have been used.
Thank you, Henning and Silvia. I think from Verra's perspective, I think we have a couple of key priorities going into the next year with plastic credits. Of course, building awareness and making sure that what really is the role and benefit of plastic credit is clearly put out to the world. And I think that's one of the impediments that we've seen, is people don't understand what plastic credits really are, what this mechanism is, how is it different from carbon credits and so on. That's one of the things. Seeing how we could find opportunities for it to be integrated into the treaty mechanism as well as regional EPRs, where there is where EPR is right now being discussed. Identify opportunities to develop that pilot project that I spoke about, and then take it to other regions where it can be replicated, because there's definitely a lot of curiosity and interest, just not enough clarity on how that integration could happen. And third is on the demand side, identify and address those barriers in terms of helping brands understand, again, the role of plastic credits and how can you safeguard yourself against the accusations of greenwashing through development of unified claims that the industry can back. So I think those three are going to be our top priorities going into the new year. And I would be very interested to hear from Henning once you have done that research in terms of, how companies are, what the sustainability journey looks like from the point that they start to purchase plastic credits. So that would be something very interesting. But I do acknowledge that these are very early days for plastic credits. It is one of the solutions. It's not just the only solution, should be viewed as such. I think it is at an inflection point. And really, it's up to a lot of us to make sure that it moves in the right direction.
Thank you so much also for wrapping up. Thank you first of all for the audience for the very interesting questions. Thank you, Komal, Silvia, Henning, for your time and your insights. It was really interesting and it was nice to talk about such an urgent topic where we all have or will be working on intensely within the next months and years as well. Again, thank you very much and have a great rest of the day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you, Silvia. Bye.